So you owe me big time, you guys.
Long ago, in a galaxy far, far away,
Star Wars toys
began, and Kenner continues the excitement.
The Empire Strikes Back collection.
El regreso del Jedi.
Welcome, welcome, welcome to the Star Wars Collectors Archive Podcast. It's the Kivecast.
Present Star Space Station with a snap-open space hatch.
Sometimes known as the Vintage Pod.
Wow, what a weird place.
A monthly audio magazine dedicated to vintage Star Wars toys and memorabilia. Hosted by Sky Payne, Fudd,
Chewbacca,
Chewbacca's here too,
and Steven B. Denton.
B-Wing Fighters and B-Wing Pilot Action, B-Wing Pilot Action, B-Wing Pilot Action, B-Wing Pilot Action.
Market data mined by Brisbane, Brisbane Mike.
Luke Skywalker handles his saber well.
And Fantastic Pete.
Boba Fett has a see-through helmet.
Tech support by The Low Ones.
For the first time, Steve and Sky are joined by Stephen J. Sansweet, who comes on to celebrate the 24th anniversary of his book, From Concept to Screen to Collectible, the foundational document of the vintage Star Wars collecting hobby. Ron Salvatore joins our conversation to discuss its impact on him and other mega collectors and Cincinnati Raiders of the early 1990s. Chris Georgoulias joins us to discuss the Klimko sales, the resurgence of Blue Harvest, and the Mailer Sampler Fett with the 70th Vintage Pod.
Wampa Wampa!
Welcome to Codcast number 70.
Number 70, Steve. So, this is the beginning of our seventh year. Is that right?
Yeah, that's nuts. Yeah.
Six full years in the books. We started this in, whatever, January, February 2010.
Yep.
And we're here. And it's actually going to be an episode of strange anniversaries. It's very exciting. We're going to talk to Steve Sansweet about his book, From Concept to Screen to Collectible, which came out in 1992. So we're celebrating its 23rd anniversary.
I have to say, when I first got that email, I couldn't remember if I saw the word anniversary in there and completely got confused or what. I'm like, well, no, that would be our way. We celebrate weird numbers. So.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, we're Star Wars collectors, right? So the most important numbers to us are like 21, 65, and 12.
Exactly. Yeah.
The funny thing is, the reason that we – so I've been talking to Steve about this since Seattle in 2013, it was. And, you know, basically, obviously, I think we're all – well, not all of us, but some of us are kind of starstruck around him because he's such a big figure in collecting in general, just in Star Wars, you know. Mm-hmm. And so I was really happy that I came up with this idea of like – because I knew Ron loved his book, From Concept to Screen to Collectible, and it was important to him. So I would go through Ron to get to him, so that way I wouldn't feel too embarrassed to like ask him to interview. And so he was totally like, yeah, that sounds great. Let's do it. But then like I just still never quite had the nerve.
Yeah.
So fortunately, Steve, you've had a complete technological breakdown. I've kept this a secret from everybody. I'm like, you know, I'm like a pilot or something who's been keeping it a secret that one of the landing gears doesn't work.
Exactly. That's the exact situation. One of the twin pods was malfunctioning.
Yes. So if you've ever seen us record a show live, you see that we use this product called Blue, which is a microphone. And it's not professional. It doesn't have one of those little weird windscreens on it.
Right.
It's just a weird – it looks like an old iPod.
Yeah.
And
looks like the like torture device on the Death Star. Like it's a little
Dr. Ball.
Right.
And so Steve got a new computer 2 months ago and it stopped working.
Mm-hmm.
And so for all of you space freaks out there, you've noticed that we've released like 8 episodes in the past 2 months.
But one of which I was completely on the phone.
Right. One of them he was on the phone, another it was like an old episode. So it's just been kind of weird. So next month, we're going to get back to our regular style Kivecast.
Right.
We're going to finally talk to Grant Criddle from the Vintage Rebellion about the TIE pilot. Unfortunately, we're too late to talk to Joe Iglesias about bootlegs to push the Outer Realm book. But hopefully that'll make its Kickstarter. I hope you don't mind, Steve. I donated $500 in our name. So if it makes, you owe me $250.
Okay.
I meant to ask you beforehand, but if not, then because if you spend that much, then you get an advertisement. So if you don't want to kick in, Steve, I'll just put a picture of a Chewbacca figure and I'll say Kivecast, listen to Sky.
Yeah, no, I think that was safe to assume I'd be with you.
Okay. Yeah, so Steve finally got... When did you get your microphone?
Okay, so, well, the whole problem started with this computer, which I had just been riding until... It's like an old car. I just really was trying to ride it till the end, and it finally just wouldn't load without being in safety mode. It's like, well, maybe Skype will still work. And so I tried it for that episode we were talking about. It was the Force Awakens reaction show, and I just could not get the thing to work. So I'm like, all right, well, I'll have to get a new computer. So I got a new computer, plugged in the old Snowball, and it just didn't recognize it at all. So I tried downloading patches, and all of a sudden, nothing was working. So it turns out, I guess, any Snowball manufactured before a certain date just doesn't work with anything current. So I'm like, well, I like the Snowball. I'd like to get another one, and I was just like praying that the next one I got would work. So I finally got it the other night, plugged it in, and it recognized it, and I'm like, oh, thank God.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's been rough. So I apologize to you for kind of being on the outs in that sense. But hopefully we're back in business.
Well, you know, buying the microphone is basically buying microphone and Skype time is essentially the only cost of this podcast besides countless hours that we don't do. So if you're a space freak and a fan of the show, buy Steve a drink because he had to buy a new microphone, okay?
No. It was overdue.
but it's actually fun. I'm recording in a new location, Steve.
Really? New studio, huh?
Well, I'm actually I'm recording in my girlfriend's house.
Oh.
And I told her that I would mention that. And I told her that, of course, what do we call all girlfriends on this show?
Lady friends, right?
She's not my special lady. She's my lady friend. I'm just helping her conceive, man.
I said lady friends, and she got really mad. She's like,
she's not the first one to get mad about that.
She's like, don't call me lady friend. I'm like, you know, Steve's lady friend said the same thing. What's wrong with lady friend, Steve?
I don't know. I think because we're such big, like, Lebowski fans, it's right. Not that that's the connection for us. So maybe not such a great general use term. I don't know.
She said, you know, that you're a feminist because I am a feminist. She's like, think like a woman and figure out why you wouldn't like it. And I can't figure it out because I only hear Jeff Bridges.
Yeah.
She's not my lady friend, man. I'm just helping her to conceive. Like, I can't think of it.
She's not my special lady. She's my lady friend. I'm just helping her conceive, man.
So I am not in my lady friend's house. I'm in my girlfriend's house.
Okay. All right.
Anyways, it's pretty crazy. We've had this insane snowstorm. I've had this kind of weird long day.
And it is. It was 88 degrees. I am in my sweat box right now. Wow, it's crazy.
But all of that is a long way of saying this is not going to be a normal episode.
No,
we're not going to have a Sky Coup. We're not going to have a flip the script. We're not going to have a market watch. It's actually just going to be two interviews. So the idea is that I'm not even going to have a random thought about Force Awakens, Steve. Even though you've now seen it several times.
I have. I figured that's... I just realized it's the most I'd ever seen any movie in the theater. And then that kind of freaked me out a little bit. But
wow.
I don't know. I like it.
Yes. Very eloquent, Mr. Danley.
Yeah, thank you.
All right. So then let's introduce this.
Okay.
So basically, if you don't know, in 1992... there was a book released by Chronicle Books, and as you'll learn in the interview, it was the first ever book about Star Wars collectibles ever written. And it's written by Stephen Sansweet, Stephen J. Sansweet. And in talking to like Gus and Ron and Chris Georgoulias, I sort of learned that this was sort of like their Bible or their Rosetta Stone, or this was sort of the thing that started them off collecting.
Right.
Not necessarily started them collecting, but like helped to sort of give form to it.
Right. Well, the mindset that the book kind of, you know, not intentionally like displays, but it's what comes from it. We'll get into it, but yeah.
Right. Yeah. Basically like process collecting and sort of, we'll get into it when we see it. But the fact that it was this important, it made me realize, hey, everybody talks to Steve Sansweet about Rancho Obi-Wan, which is great. Everyone should join and go visit. And everyone should appreciate the videos that he makes and the fact that, you know, he's the face of Star Wars collecting. But here's this one book that I just we should be talking about. And especially now as everything becomes all Facebook and everything becomes all shattered and talk about centralized. This was when there was one book that had this information. You know, this is where people learned what a first shot was, and people learned what a hard copy was. This was 3 years even before the Star Wars Collector's Archive went online.
Right, know? Right.
This is really the beginning point.
The genesis, of that whole realm of collecting.
Steve, I know there's a word for it that would be good to indicate the beginning of something. But I don't know why I can't figure out the metaphor. Because touchstone doesn't work.
No.
Big Bang is stupid. And my dad hates the Big Bang and doesn't believe in the Big Bang. It's a whole thing. There should be some, like, I call it the alpha at one point, but
yeah,
that makes it seem like it's the best. I mean, like, it's the beginning. It's the episode one of collecting books?
No. See that? Yeah.
No, that wouldn't go well. That's funny. All right, we'll figure it out. Send your suggestions, kivecast@gmail.com. Although we're not doing feedback either this month. So we'll read it on episode 71. So let's get to our interview, and it's going to be with Steve and I talking very little, and Steven Sansweet and Ron Salvatore talking about this book. Sound good, Steve?
Sounds good.
And I do mention that that you are the Steve of the podcast, and I demoted him to the other Steve. So,
you know, it's funny. I got that exact thing happen to me in high school. I was the other Steve in high school. So there's some part of me that's just prepared.
Now you're the Steve, it's almost obscene. But
I'd say it's beyond obscene. But
all right, let's hear.
Where do people get information about vintage Star Wars collectibles? Before podcasts and Facebook groups, there were message boards. Before message boards, there was the Star Wars Collector's Archive. And even before the Star Wars Collector's Archive, there was Stephen J. Sansweet's 1992 book, Star Wars, From Concept to Screen to Collectible. This is the foundational document of our hobby, the book that created the vintage collector mindset. The book that introduced terms like hard copy and first shot, the first photographic display of a pre-production run on the legendary page 93, the first book to talk about the creation and collecting of Star Wars memorabilia, from Gamorrean guard banks to Darth Vader sculpts. This is the book that started it all, and its author is joining us on the Kivecast right now.
So I am joined here by Ron Salvatore and someone who we're now, strangely enough, calling the other Steve Sansweet, to talk about a book. And it's – actually, I did some research, Steve, and it turns out this was not your first ever book. It's your first ever Star Wars book.
Right.
It turns out your first book was called The Punishment Cure.
Yes.
Do you talk about that at all?
No.
Okay.
Well, it was, I'll tell you what, it was a front page story I did in the Wall Street Journal about aversion therapy. And I got approached by a publisher and I thought, this is the only chance in my lifetime that I am ever going to have a chance to write a book. So even though I disbelieved in the subject and it was sort of a weird book and almost immediately went to the remainder tables, it was a book. So I figured, okay, I can now die peacefully having a book to my name.
Okay, well, at some point we'll have to discuss how that has had an impact on your collecting, but that's for another podcast. And then I've never actually been able to find it, but apparently you also released a book on science fiction toys and models in 1980. Yeah, is that correct?
Yeah, this was a Starlog book, so it's more pamphlety than it is book-like, and there occasionally, if you look on eBay, there are some people who have copies of it. It was, you know, like a couple of dollar book. They did a series of Starlog photo guidebooks, and I had the great pleasure of working with Bob Burns, who has probably the most amazing science fiction toy collection and prop collection, because so many people gave him all the guys he worked with gave him lots of props. He's got some amazing Star Wars props, the original time machine, just great stuff.
Yeah, and he's got an amazing collection.
He does. And a guy named Mike Miner. And Mike was a neighbor. And Mike was assistant art director on Star Trek 1 and art director on Star Trek 2. And Mike then unfortunately passed away. But good guy. And Mike was making the settings for these toys. Like in 5 minutes, he would create new planets. It was amazing to behold.
I am happy to say I have a copy of that book somewhere. And if you're listening and you don't have it, you should seek it out just for your collecting library, because it's actually a pretty good book. I seem to remember it's very brief, but it's got some great photography
in it. It's got some wonderful photography and fun captions and amazing old collectible toys, a lot of the Japanese robots and rockets that was from Bob's collection. And I am very proud that even in 1980, I managed to get some Star Wars figures on the cover. So that was my little contribution.
Well, that's all great, but that isn't what we actually came here to talk about. We're not talking about aversion therapy or Starlog. But actually, this whole thing started by, you know, so it's probably no secret for people who listen to the show. I look up a fair amount to Ron Salvatore. You know, I really like the way he writes and the way he talks about toys. And I was talking to him one day sort of about what sort of inspired him. And he, you know, just came right out and said, you know, reading the 1992 book written by Steve Sansweet, Star Wars from Concept to Screen to Collectible, was kind of like one of the main things that got him going. And I sort of had talks with other of the sort of grand old vintage collectors, and they all kind of seem to say that...
I don't think I've reached that level yet. Probably not. Steve's probably rolling his eyes right now and thinking, I sure am.
And what it made me realize, Steve, is that, I mean, certainly you're well-recognized as having the biggest collection in the world and as being this great ambassador and collector. But I don't think that this book, this 1992 book, has actually gotten its full due in terms of the amount of things that it introduced into the collector lexicon, the way it seemed to almost really create the vintage collecting hobby the way that it sort of is now. And it's almost like you're a victim of your own fame, where I think people just go, oh, of course, Steve knows everything. He does everything. But this actual book, I really thought, let's just take a whole episode to just break down what made it interesting, what made it new, and sort of what's the story behind this book. And the one last thing I'll say in terms of kissing butt is the thing I think we're really lucky for is that you're a writer. And so it's a really well-written book. And so to have this as sort of like the first book of its kind sort of creates a standard that I don't think everyone else has. And that we're really lucky that like whoever it is that edits or doesn't edit Tomart, for example, you know, like just how lucky we are to have something that's well-written, that's funny, it's well-designed. And anyway, I just want to say that. So, Ron, now you can ask a question. Now I'm done kissing butt. What's a good question?
Well, yeah, I mean, I agree with everything you said. And just to the point, kind of bouncing off some of what you said, I looked at Amazon today at the book, and I noticed that the top review is by one guy named Gus Lopez, which I think is from the late 90s or early 2000s, who obviously has a connection to Star Wars collecting and to Amazon, so it kind of makes sense that he'd be commenting. But he has a lot of great things to say about the book, and, you know, again, that's going back 15, 16 years, so, you know, I think people like Gus and myself had definitely took a lot of influence from that early on, just because of the time it came out and all the great stuff that was in it. But how did you get started with that, Steve? I mean, you were obviously working at the Wall Street Journal at that time, a sci-fi and Star Wars collector. How did that, you know, project come up?
Well, the first time I had interviewed George Lucas was in 1987, and it was for an op-edit page piece for the Wall Street Journal on the first 10 years of Star Wars. I tried everything to get up to the ranch, and the PR lady, who has become a really good friend, Lean Hale, said, no, we can do it on the phone. So I thought, damn, got to come up with some other reason. But in the early 90s, I had heard just through the network. There was a network before there was an internet, believe it or not, of people who sort of knew people who knew people and talked to each other or even wrote to each other. And I I had heard that Lucasfilm had just started up its publishing division again after having it closed down for all of those years, you know, the dark period, mostly between 86 and 94, and that they had started up, they had appointed somebody as head of publishing and had started up this publishing division. And that one of the first books that were working on some fiction, but that the first nonfiction book was going to be a price guide. And I thought, well, heck, if anybody does a price guide, it should be me. And so I called the head of PR, and she told me who the head of a new head of publishing was. And I cold called, and I said basically the same thing. I hear you're, you know, I blah blah blah, I work for the Wall Street Journal and got this big collection, and if anybody does a price guide, it should be me. And basically she said, and who the hell are you? And so we had this long discussion, and she started saying, well, yeah, you know, I really want a price guide. At that point she didn't tell me that she had almost definitely had picked Tomart to do the price guide, but she said, you know, it'd be really good to have a writer on board because I want the price guide to have anecdotes. Mm-hmm. And I said, excuse me, I don't quite get it. Well, I want it to have stories in it. And I said, well, you know, that's not really a price guide, because there had been a couple of unofficial price guides, as we know, done by Mike and Sue Cott mainly, and done unofficially, but done by Lucasfilm's publisher Random House, and they're the generic title of all of these collectible books was The Official Guide to, you know, copyright, but of course it wasn't. And I said, well, you know, Lucy, this was Lucy Wilson. I'm having a little problem sort of, you know, I see the need to a price guide. I want to work on that. But I think what you're talking about is a book that's different, you know, like a real mm-hmm. book with stories in it. But, you know, can we get together and can we talk about it? And so I arranged to go up to Skywalker, and we had a long lunch. And out of that lunch, we came up with the idea of doing a book about merchandise, but in a an anecdotal kind of way. Mm-hmm. And then we got Chronicle Books. Chronicle Books was just sort of starting. There was a member of the McAvoy family, which owned, you know, they owned the San Francisco Chronicle and Cron TV and the radio stations and everything. And Nyan had just taken over. Nyan McAvoy had just taken over as publisher of Chronicle Books. And he desperately, you know, they're San Francisco, he desperately wanted to be on the ground floor of Star Wars books. And so then we had another meeting, and we all sort of talked about it. And he said, well, you know, the merchandise is fine, but wouldn't it be great to sort of have something that went from the movie to the merchandise? And I said, well, yeah, sure. And that's – so it was a bunch of people thinking about a bunch of things that came up with the basic idea, and eventually then with the very unwieldy title, which I fought against but lost, from concept to screen to collectible. And there were a number of other titles which I have since forgotten that were much shorter, but really that title – you know, says what the book is.
Mm-hmm. It's very illustrative. So you don't remember any of the ones that you liked more?
Star Wars, we win. No, I don't. it's something, you know, we tried like from film to shelf, or right. It was dumb. kinds of things to try to keep it short. And then Chronicle decided on you know, what the title was going to be. So then it became me sort of working out a game plan and just sort of laying out the book and figuring out how to do it. And that's when I came up with the idea is, well, we start with the general idea in George's mind. How did the movie come about? Then, how did it get translated to the screen by the magicians at ILM? And then, how did the merchandise come in, and how much of a role the merchandise played in really keeping and making Star Wars what it is today, even though right then it was, you know, before all the big announcements of the special editions and things like that. And so this was an idea that that everybody approved, that it would be this tripartite thing. And you have to remember, there hadn't been any Star Wars books that had been done since the 80s. And nobody had done a book like this, and nobody had written about the merchandise. And so I was very excited because it would just test my reporting skills to figure out, first of all, to start with George, and then go to some of the, you know, very early guys at ILM, and then go to Cincinnati and attack Kenner, which was a well planned but in the beginning a very disappointing kind of journey.
Really?
Well, I'll tell you, we started out with the interview with George, and that was supposed to be limited, and it was amazing that I even got as much time as you know, I got to a two-hour interview. But George and I really hit it off, and it was great, and he kept me there for another half an hour, and we were just, you know, shooting the breeze. And so I got some really, really great stuff. While I was up there, I went to Ralph McQuarrie's house in Berkeley and spent time with Ralph, and then got to interview some of the really early guys who worked on Star Wars, like Steve Gawley and people like that, people who have won 8 or 9 Academy Awards and are still at Lucasfilm, and then, you know, planning the big, you know, Kenner trip, you know, with Lucasfilm's blessing and all that kind of stuff, and that became a really important part of the book. I mean, because I was convinced and had been convinced that it was the merchandise, you know, collect all 12, collect all 92, that really has kept Star Wars alive all these years. And, you know, not just from hardcore collectors, and there were some. I mean, in the late 80s, there were a number of people who had some really amazing collections, and for whatever reason were selling them. Because of divorces, or because of loss of interest, or because of things like that. And I really built my collection on the bones of a lot of those major collections, sort of preserving a lot of the things that had been put together that would be, you know, impossible or, you know,
right,
expensive as hell, especially these days, to try to get together. Like Walt Steuben, who mm-hmm. had probably the biggest Star Wars collection in the world, and lived in Western Pennsylvania, and in fact Hasbro or Kenner had brought him up to Toy Fair one year to put together a display of his toys, which is pretty funny because decades later, Hasbro had me do the same thing at Comic-Con. So, yeah, what comes around goes around.
But, well, you know, Steve, Ron and I have been working on a song called The Ballad of Walter Steuben. So Ron's been writing the lyrics, and I've been working on the music. But
he's exaggerating. We did a blog post, Steve. I just did a post about Walt Steuben and about his setting up at Toy Fair, which you just mentioned, and it's pretty interesting. And actually, one of his family members posted a comment on it that said he'd recently passed away. I think it was maybe a couple of years ago. It was disappointing.
Yeah, the last I had known, I was in touch with Walt several years ago, and he was collecting Transformers. Mm-hmm. Once a collector, always a collector, I guess.
Yeah, I think I may have helped you get in touch with him, because he had bought something from me on eBay.
Yes.
Some random thing, and I was like, Walter Steuben. And then we started emailing, and I remember talking to you about it, and, no one had heard from him, it seems like, in a while at that time. But, it's too bad to hear that he passed.
Yeah, we had a nice chat, I remember that, and I, said, thank you, you're responsible for, a major backbone of this collection, and really... getting me to think that this is more than a small hobby. This is something that I really want to concentrate on. So I had this great interview with George. I had some really cool interviews with the ILM folks. And then I go to Cincinnati, and the first thing I say is, well, I would like to look in your files first. And the reply was... What files? They didn't even have copies of their retail catalogs.
Wow. This is Kenner?
This is Kenner.
Yeah, I'm not surprised.
This is Kenner in 1990-91, and there were no photos. Very few paper, a couple of scattered catalogs among the years, and I'm thinking, oh my goodness, because when I first went to Lucasfilm and I talked to Lucy Wilson, and I said, well, the first thing I want to do, Lucy, is look through all of the early licensing files from 1977 through, at least 1986, and I think I'm going to find a lot of stuff in there. And she said, I guess I shouldn't have thrown those away 6 years ago.
And just so the listener who doesn't own this book knows, I mean, the book, that it's very extensive in terms of the information it has about Kenner. I believe it's the first time first shot and hard copy were used as terms, taken outside to collectors. And it must have been one of the first places anyone talked about blue snaggleteeth, and it talks about the sculptors and Loomis and Lippincott and Bordeaux, all these names that I assume had never appeared anywhere else.
Correct.
So the finished product appears as though, Steve, that you just walked into Cincinnati and everyone just opened up the doors and gave you pictures of things like the sculpt for Darth Vader, which is just sitting here on page 68. So this is amazing.
Or I got them all from the Lucasfilm catalogs and paperwork. Luckily, some of the licensing material had been kept, duplicates had been kept in the legal files. Mm-hmm. So I did spend a week or two, literally, at Lucasfilm, and days and nights, and going through all of the legal files, where I found things like the federal government, didn't want to let them license the X-Wing fighter because they were afraid it had some military aspect. And,
national security.
All those great anecdotes, which I hear repeated back to me constantly over the years. Did you know? I said, sort of knew that.
That's great. What was the craziest thing you found in those files? Do you have one? Or is the X-Wing the weirdest one?
The files on the merchandise, the X-Wing was probably the one that got me scratching my head the most. And, and then there were photos from Takara, and they were, to show size reference, they were photographing toys next to cigarette packs, and... It's just like, okay, well, you know, and the things that they turned down, like a Star Wars light bulb and
the liquor decanter.
Star Wars Darth Vader sunglasses, which of course we know they don't turn down today.
No. We have Yoda grapes, Steve. So I mean, all the boundaries have been crossed.
Yoda grapes, Vader apples, and BB-8 oranges. Yes, indeed. And I've niblet corn from Hungary. And yes, wow. The barriers are long gone. So, well, the barriers were gone when I started collecting fresh chicken parts in France. But that's another.
It's
funny that you talk about the anecdotes, because I was looking through the book again, and there are so many things that I thought were just common knowledge, but then it really turned, like the fact that Lucas's favorite item was the Rumpf mug or whatever.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I've always known that, and the snarling Chewbacca, because I'm a Chewbacca guy, so the snarling Chewbacca was by Don Post was put away in favor of the one with the closed mouth. And I just kind of now realized, like, oh, this is probably why I know of this, and just all these great stories.
Oh, yeah. I think that was the first time I remember ever reading anything like that. And like Steve said, that stuff has trickled through collecting, so if people just say it, even if they haven't read the book, they've heard that stuff. So.
There was nothing in print that was anything like this book, which was why it was so exciting for me to do. It was a lot of work, but I was lucky that at Kenner there were people who were so proud of the work that they had done that they had kept their own things, and chief among them were people like, well, certainly Mark Boudreau, who started there, you know, as a college student in a sort of a work study program, and has been the guy on Star Wars ever since. Mm-hmm. And has gotten, you know, even this year an award for some of his work on Star Wars. And mm-hmm. Bernie Loomis was still alive, and I was able to interview him by phone. Dave Okada, I think by then Dave had gone to Mattel, but I was able to do an in-person interview with him. Mm-hmm. Tom Osborne, Jim Swearengen, just mm-hmm. was a fount of knowledge. He has just a great memory on specifics. Dave Maurer, who was the marketing guy. But Mark was amazing. Mark said, I've kept a lot of the drawings that I did and some of the photos that we did at the time of the mock-ups. And I even have a couple of missile-firing Boba Fett prototypes in the closet at home. And and so I said, Mark, if you could bring that stuff in and if we could get it photographed, that would be amazing. So a lot of the really cool old stuff in the book and plans and things that don't exist anymore, and some of the great photos of the Jane Abbott dolls, the 12-inch action figures with a lot of that came from Mark. And well, he was just wonderful and charming.
Yeah, I mean, that's interesting. And that's a question I actually have. It's always intrigued me, is where some of the photos in the book came from. For instance, the one of the yak face, the Darth Vader, and the C-3PO sculpts lined up next to their production counterparts. I mean, were those things that they took and at the time for you? But that looks like
Boudreau actually took those. Those were things that were taken for the book. That certain people still had those. And it wasn't, Mark had a lot of them, but there were other people who were then also willing to bring in some of the pieces that that they had rescued. And because there was no, I mean, I thought, well, there's some archives building someplace. Well, no, there wasn't. I mean, there was a Lucasfilm licensing archive, and so such as it was, you know, it was behind chain link fence in a barn, and so I was able to go through that and find a number of things that I was able to take photographs of or or mention in the book. That grew over the years, of course, and that has now all gone down to Southern California. It's all in Disney's hands. It's locked up. It's, I don't know what's happening to that archive, but all I know is that Lucasfilm and Disney bring retailers through here to show them the history of Star Wars licensing.
There's no other place
to do it.
Mm-hmm.
But Mark Boudreau was really central in so much of this, especially not only the great stories he told and the explanations of the mini rigs and how he came up with those things, but also for the visuals and getting, you know, some of the other guys that he knew were there who still had some of the visuals, and hearing Jim Swearengin talk about how he developed the X-Wing and the reasons why it wasn't exactly like, you know, the version right. that you saw in the movie. I mean, there were reasons for all of these things. There were cost right. reasons. There were other kinds of reasons. And then I had to balance things like, you know, Bernie Loomis's ego with the stories that I heard from the team as to, you know, whose great idea this was. And
yeah.
you know, clearly it was the team getting excited about the script and some of the scrap that they had seen or the photos that they had seen and convincing, you know, Bernie. And then hearing that word from Bernie that I had never heard before, toyetic, mm-hmm. which is a word that has, you know, has sort of become much more commonplace. It was toyetic. It was
right.
that George had come up with, you know, such an amazing galaxy with so many different characters and vehicles and scenes that would make great playsets. And the fact that they signed the contract the month before the movie came out.
Yeah, right.
And therefore couldn't get any three-dimensional stuff out that first year, and then took that big risk on the early bird certificate package.
Mm-hmm.
These were all great stories. And it's yeah. just not everything positive. I mean, you know, reporter for the Wall Street Journal, and I wanted all the stories, and I, you know, found you know, all the news clips and newspaper stories about, you know, people just railing on Kenner for the nerve of selling a cardboard kit at Christmas time. And then there are people who have mistakenly picked up things from the book and sort of turned it around, saying, yes, Kenner sold 600,000 of these certificate kits, and they all sold out, and people were going, They sold less than half of them.
Huh. Yeah, yeah.
There was this French show a couple of years ago at one of the Louvre related museums, and I remember reading the copy, and it was, you know, because I had to edit the copy, and it was like, yes, they sold out 500,000 of these kits, and I said, no.
Nope.
No, that's not quite true. And then a lot of the photography in the book was new photography taken by my friend Steve Essig, did a beautiful job in, as well as, you know, as being able to, you know, rework some of the early stuff. This was really before Photoshop, so, you know, anything that was done. And then they picked this husband-wife team to do the design of the book. They also did my first Star Wars scrapbook, and mm-hmm. and we all put it together, and it worked out great.
It's funny what you're saying about the anecdotes that get passed down, but then there's some that I'm amazed haven't been passed on.
Yeah, like I feel the same.
Like everyone talks about that. they were hesitant because, you know, they didn't like making toys based on movies. And I've heard that a million times. But then I just read today, or reread, that it was because Fox made Dr. Doolittle toys in 1967. Right. And that because the giraffe Jack-in-the-Box, I looked it up, because that couldn't sell, they knew that this wouldn't work. And that's why you needed Bernie Loomis to say it was toyetic. You needed someone who really believed in it to sell it. But, I mean, that's, we should be talking about Dr. Doolittle all the time in our hobby.
Well, right. I mean, you know, Bernie was convinced that by the time they came out with their three-dimensional figure, they had, their contract was just like, okay, we will produce this year at least one family-oriented board game.
Yeah.
Period.
Yeah, that's another anecdote that doesn't get talked about that much, and actually we did a blog post on that too about the misconception that somehow Kenner was caught with their pants down, when it's like, well, no, they just signed the contract a month before the movie came out.
Right.
Yeah, and they only agreed, really, to make a board game.
Nobody else would.
Yeah.
And then another thing in the book is that part of the reason Kenner invested in it was that they thought there was a chance there would be a TV show as good as the Planet of the Apes TV show that would come out of this movie, and that's where they'd get the money. I'd never heard that anywhere else either. We need to start spreading this because that's really interesting.
That's exactly right. And part of the contract and part of the deal was that they would have the rights for the TV show. And in fact, George and Fox had talked about a TV show, and that's part of the initial contract that George signed with Fox. And so instead of Star Wars on TV, we got Battlestar Galactica. But there could have been a Star Wars TV show, and those were the toys that were selling. Obviously, Star Trek and Battle of the Apes and things like that, which were on in your house every week, and there were just networks back then, and there was not 50,000 channels and streaming this and streaming that. That was a pretty good bet if it was a popular series. And in this case, Bernie was convinced that people would have forgotten the movie by the time they got their action figures out, but that's when the word toyetic came about, that we can build a wonderful space line even though nobody knows or nobody really remembers this movie. Certainly nobody expected a sequel, and absolutely nobody, including George and Fox, thought that it would be the cultural, I mean, forget about monetary success, but that it would be the cultural phenomenon that it became that year. And there are all kinds of historic reasons why, and we explore some of that too in the book. And,
right.
And the dark times politically in the United States with the Nixon impeachment and the Vietnam War and the dark movies that were winning all the awards, because that was sort of the feeling. And here's George is coming along who wants to make this fun Flash Gordon space fantasy that has, you know, nothing to do with, you know, present day, really, although, you know, he clearly the evil empire was the evil empire, and in a way it was the United States government,
right?
And the rebels,
don't
the
tell
rebels,
anybody
no and the rebels but the rebels were the Viet Cong. Well, there was this nasty review from some cineast magazine in France in which the guy got it just the opposite and said that, you know, he was portraying the Viet Cong freedom fighters as the empire.
Oh my god.
And that the resistance was the American
Steve, there was an American president for 8 years who also took a similar view of Star Wars. So
well, and that's why the movie never was shown in the Soviet Union. It was not until the dissolution of the Soviet Union that Star Wars got legitimate movie play in 1991, because the Soviet Union became, under Ronald Reagan, the evil empire,
right.
And the media called his strategic defense initiative the Star Wars defense, And in fact, Lucasfilm sued the Associated Press and lost because of it. But it's everything is involved with everything else.
And bringing it back to the toys too, another anecdote that I would thought I would have heard more, but that Kenner was very hesitant to make any guns because it was so close to Vietnam that everyone was down on toy guns. And so, right? Is that still true?
That has become a controversial anecdote.
Oh, okay.
Going back about 10 or 12 years, I got a note from George's office, and somebody had found that quote in the book, and George was not happy about it or said something, you know. And I had to write a memo back saying, this came from the head of Kenner Toys, and I did pass it by George, and he didn't deny it at the time. Nobody really gets killed. I mean, they get sort of, you don't see the blood, though, and it's all, you know, sort of fantasy. And so... and I never heard another word.
Wow,
that's interesting.
These things last forever. I mean, you know, once something's in print, whether it then becomes something that people talk about as everybody knows that blah 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 blah.
Right.
It's believable too, because I mean, Lucas is coming out of the whole let's make a Flash Gordon-style movie, and when they merchandised all that stuff, the serials, they always had the ray guns. So it's a believable anecdote.
Well, and probably it was around the time that Steven Spielberg was taking the guns out of the hands of the FBI agents.
Oh, yeah.
In that one redo of E.T., which he then reversed himself again and added them back in. But it was probably... It was probably around that time, and somebody had approached, you know, Lucasfilm about that, and so I had to say, well, George had no problem with it at the time, so, you know.
It's really weird. In the Disney parks most recently, they just kind of pulled all of the Star Wars guns from the shops, and it's just funny to hear this. I read that anecdote today, and to see it and think I was just there, you know, a few weeks ago. And an employee actually told us that, oh, yeah, it just came down. We're not selling any guns in the parks anymore, including Star Wars guns. So it's just...
Well, there is this... you know, the world changes.
Yeah.
And people change. And it's sort of like when they sold the Slave Leia Big Fig at the parks during Star Wars weekends years ago. And someone complained... and they immediately took it off sale, and it was gone for about 4 or 5 weeks until it was repackaged as Leia as Jabba's dancing girl.
Which, so, you know, I guess is somewhat better than slave.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, you know, there are words that have different connotations today. It's just sort of... You know, that wonderful series All in the Family with Archie Bunker, you could not run today because people would get offended. It was deliberately offensive and humorous at the same time. And
he's not likable.
No, but, he was too likable.
All right, now I have one question that is always, I've always wondered, I've always wanted to ask you. So one of the most common things that people ask whenever they start collecting is how many toys were sold. And I've never, ever seen any answer to this except in your book, in which you say that in 78 they sold 43 million figures, including 26 million, I guess, 12 packs. And then you then say, can you believe collectors pay up to $100 a piece? but... Where did you get that number?
Yeah, things have changed a bit.
Huh? Yeah, they have. Where did you get that number, and are there more numbers where you found those?
Yes, there are more numbers. I had found in the legal files the Hasbro reports to Lucasfilm
Oh, wow.
For the first couple of years. And so I knew specifically how many puzzles, how many action figures, and I was able to get those figures from the royalty reports that that Kenner had sent to Lucasfilm. And it's just like that figure of 250 million action figures sold between 1978 and 1986 mm-hmm. was also from a Kenner report to Lucasfilm. Somewhere in the Rancho Obi-Wan deep storage files, there are probably photocopies of some of the material that I put together for this book. Obviously, you have so much space for a book. I had plenty of stuff, and then they decided to insert these for to make the book look good. All of a sudden, I see a first proof, and I see these double page photos to start chapters with quotes in them, and saying, what the heck is all this? And then the cover, which has no type on it whatsoever.
Yeah, it doesn't.
Mm-hmm. And so actually, this is my partner Bob's idea to photograph the prototype gold Darth Vader mm-hmm. carrying case. And that's what we sent in. And out of that, they decided they photostatted.
That was Bob's idea.
It was his idea for the cover, and oh, wow. and then but then they made it the way that they did. They
quadrants or something.
Solarized it in quadrants and things like that.
And that kind of made that Vader case an iconic item. Mm-hmm. You know, it's for me anyway. Whenever I see that Vader case, which is around in a few collections,
Of course, the only reason I wrote this book was to increase the value of my collection.
There's probably some idiots out there who actually think that. So,
let me tell you guys, I was a journalist all my life. I had all of the ethics and the morals of a Wall Street Journal reporter. Mm-hmm. And so I saw stuff all over Kenner. All I had to do was say, but might you be interested in selling something like that? And I did. And all you guys rushed in where I feared to tread. No, and I do not regret that. I do not regret that one.
Well, that was on my list of questions, Steve, was that as a collector, this is a collecting podcast. I mean, the temptation must have been huge to sort of make offers to people for different things. I guess you just answered it, but you resisted that for the most part?
I resisted it completely. Mm-hmm. And believe me, it was tempting, but believe me, I also felt that I had a job to do, and this was not something that I wanted to mix as a collector and as a writer, and especially being someone who would be going back to the Wall Street Journal. Hell, at the time I was bureau chief in Los Angeles.
Right.
And it just did not seem right to me. Mm-hmm. You know, in retrospect, I say, you fool you, but no, I do not regret making that choice at all. And it also, I'm so thankful that it started people like you guys. Without fans, without collectors with a passion for this stuff, so much of what we have now that is in private collections would have been lost forever. We see that Kenner did not keep things. We see that Lucasfilm trashed things. I mean, I did get a little bit of a reputation as a dumpster diver at Lucasfilm. But I always asked. I always asked, and they always gave me a strange look, and usually they said, well, yeah, I was just going to throw it away anyway, as long as you don't sell it, And you've been here. Right? We haven't sold it. We just keep adding. So,
yeah.
But it was, yeah, it was very much one of those situations. I still remember seeing the Star Tots and the X-Wing fighter and the land speeder that they had made mm-hmm. for it. And I just fell in love with those things. But it was not, it was, and the dolls, the prototype.
Oh, yeah. Well, there's one upstairs right now.
Yeah. Well, that's good.
It was only 4 or 5 years later, Steve, that, you know, I was out there in Cincinnati with, you know, guys like Gus and Chris Georgoulias and Todd Chamberlain looking for stuff. And, you know, I can remember finding things and being like, this is the exact same piece that is in Steve's book. It's the item. And it's just a little bit trippy almost to realize that.
So you owe me big time, you guys.
I would not deny that at all.
I left all that stuff for you to discover, and I'm happy. I mean, this group of collectors, this informal, semi-formal, worldwide group of passionate fans that have kept the story not only alive, but have added so much through the Star Wars archive site, through the archive cast, through writing blogs. I mean, it's just wonderful. We wouldn't have had all this stuff or most of this stuff without fans being out there going through old Kenner phone directories.
Todd Chamberlain and I on downtime in Cincinnati, to your book, to just find names to then go look up the names in the phone book.
It was that easy? Oh, man.
in looking through the book, I realized that it was not just the names I mentioned, but a lot of the photos I had asked, okay, well, who carved this and who did that? And so there are a lot of other names that mm-hmm. are scattered through the book in addition to the guys that I was able to interview. And stayed friendly with. Well, I have stayed friendly with Mark all these years, and you know, it's just it's been great because you get a guy like Mark Boudreau who has this same passion not only for creating these things but also the history and the knowledge that they're only too happy to share. And that's what makes it so exciting that this stuff is there. We share it all. We don't keep it to ourselves. We don't stab each other in the back. Well, with one or
usually.
Two exceptions.
Yeah.
For the most part,
you know, if somebody's out there trying to make a buck on something phony. Mm-hmm. You know, we let each other know about it, and so it's just a wonderful huge family.
I think you're right, and you know, some of these people I've known for 20 plus years, and you know, it's a great community.
God, you are old.
Oh, it is terrible, Steve. You know, when I first probably met you, I was about the youngest person I knew in the hobby, and here I am now being called an old-timer by Sky Payne.
I say it out of deference because, I mean, the whole thing is, you know, it's like, I don't know. So I've been working on this theory for a while about, like, the generations of vintage Star Wars collectors. Uh-huh. And so, obviously, people who actually bought them at the time, that's the first generation. And then I sort of put like Ron and Gus and Chris. And so I sort of think of them as like the, you know, concept of collectible collectors. Like I actually think of it in terms of like, this was the book.
We could have the gold, bronze and silver age of collecting.
Well, because
yeah, it's a little bit like that.
But because when I started, a lot of the attention was on Kellerman's book. Right. And so there's a lot of people who really, that was sort of their main reference base. And I realized something. So I've been obsessed with the fact that Ron and Gus and Chris and those guys in general, they don't care that much about two-dimensional pre-production items. And they definitely don't care about cardback variations. And then I was looking through Kellerman, and of course Kellerman is all proof cards, chroma lens, and cardback variations.
All that stuff comes out of John's book, man. All that.
And none of it is in Steve's book.
Right.
No, because so, nobody cared before John.
And another thing is, I didn't know that stuff existed. I never asked about the process. And so, and anyway, most of it was off site by that time. And we know where it went, and that's now gotten, you know, pretty well shared. So it's great. People are interested in various aspects, but there's so much, and there's still stuff that we're discovering. It's just, you know,
it's cool because you were like, so it's like these different taste makers. I sort of see it as like showing up, and like one of my favorite things is like the things that meant a lot to you that then meant a lot to collectors like Ron, but then have kind of died off. But like, I think we need to bring them back. And the one example I have is what you, I believe the only place in the book that you use the term Holy Grail. Do you know what that is in refers to, Steve?
God, I don't.
It was the Gamorrean guard bank.
Ah, yes. Right. My big mistake.
And the thing is that Ron has a write-up of it on the archive, and it's one of the great, it's one of the oldest entries. You know, it's the super old format. So I think it'd be really fun just to talk about like that piece and talk about, you know, why it meant so much then and what do you think has been the sort of evolution of that item over the years.
Well, of course, I made a big mistake on that because it was produced. It was produced and sold in Australia in a box. And so, and then I learned after my first interview with Starlog magazine back in the 80s, never to use the term Holy Grail or explain what my Holy Grail is, because I said, well, you know, it was a couple of years ago, and there was this Return of the Jedi bike boxed at Toys R Us, and it was $69.99, and I passed by, and I wish I had bought it. So that's sort of my Holy Grail. I'm looking for one. And within a week of the article coming out, about 2 months later, I had gotten a call from a dealer on the East Coast and a dealer on the West Coast, and they both had my Holy Grail, and they both had it mint in the box, and they each quoted me the same price, $2,000. And I laughed.
I know you had the same experience with the Huffy bike, because I remember being semi-involved with somebody trying to sell you a Huffy bike and you telling me that same sort of thing.
Like, well, the Huffy bike, I ended up buying two of them because eventually it was a guy who had worked for Kenner and had bought them from the company store.
Oh, wow.
And then I traded one plus some cash to get one with the store display. Mm-hmm. This was also my wonderful, wonderful gift to humankind, getting 500 Revenge of the Jedi mint card proofs and selling them for $5 each.
Well, yeah, Steve Denny's got you beat on that one, though, so he probably sold them for $3 a piece.
Yeah,
that's a tough one.
There's only one Steve Denny. But you know what? It's you know, you look at the prices now and you go, you know, that's so ridiculous. And,
yeah, I mean,
and yet, you know, it is.
One of my questions, too, Steve, was just when you're doing the book, obviously, this is probably some of the first time. You know, one of the first times a collector's really coming face to face with some of this pre-production stuff, you know, wax sculpts for figures and micro collection pieces and whatnot. And did you ever think that after putting this in the book, you know, 20 years down the road, these things were going to be, you know, collectibles that people are out there trying to find? Or was it just, oh, this is behind the scenes stuff that is just going to be kept at Kenner? I mean, did you ever have any inkling that this would be worth what it is today?
No, I did not. And you see, I don't put any kind of price in it. I thought, you know, these are one of a kind pieces. They've probably disappeared or will disappear. And so, you know, that was the whole thing that the book led to, was people looking for these things and starting to put values on these things. And that's cool. So, I mean, it took the hobby to a different level of, you know, let's bring it back to the source. Well, if we're back that far, you know, can we find the original, you know, wooden sculpt for the hull of this ship? Or how about the original engineering drawings? Or, you know, there's so many different parts of the process, which I really didn't go into because this was a more general book. that people have now written about, which is really cool. So yeah. I mean, you can find out just about any kind of information that you're interested in.
Yeah, I mean, there's one photo in particular in here that the Steve Varner sculpts for the Lucan Hoff micro piece.
I was just looking at that. Yeah.
And there's the wax, and then there's a hard copy. It looks like the wax may have been modified because the arm's a little different. But then there's also some, you know, conceptual, and then later on, you know, later metal figures in front of it. I mean, that one picture to me has had a huge influence just on the way people could collect pre-production items, you know, when trying to assemble different stages of things. Which, to me, comes all out of this one picture. You know, it's people seeing it in this book, and then
page 93,
you know, guys like, you know, Chris Georgoulias doing that, and then putting a photo on the web, and then other people saying, "Oh, geez, you know, I can do that." And now that's like commonplace in the hobby, which is pretty fascinating.
Yeah, that's what I meant. I was going through the book, and I happened to open to that page, and I saw Steve Varner's name, and thought, "Well, yeah, I mean, that's another guy that I mentioned I had never met, but I try to mention as many of the people as I could, if anybody there knew, okay, well, whose idea was this, or who sculpted this, or how did this come about?" And, Chris, I've always been a sucker for the micro collection, even though it was a huge failure. Mm-hmm. So,
But I mean,
I love the paperwork. I love the chroma lens. It's just, you know, and I've got a little bit of this and a little bit of that and box flats and things, but, you know, different people get excited about different things, and that's what's so great about the hobby. There's enough stuff out there for all of us, and hopefully, this is going to get passed on. I mean, you know, we're all. I mean, Ron, look, he's getting really old.
Oh man, my back's starting to hurt. My hair's almost gone. I just don't even know what I'm doing anymore. But the hobby keeps changing. You know, it keeps rolling on, and you know, I feel like we're onto a new sort of era here with, you know, Facebook and everything else. So it's true, you know, but just to get back to the book, I do feel like that kind of started a lot of things, you know, just in the collecting mentality. I mean, this book that came out in 92, as you mentioned earlier, during a fairly dark time for Star Wars stuff, I know I was, a teenager when I first saw it, and suddenly it dawned on me that, oh, geez, I mean, I like Star Wars, and I collected these toys, and, you know, I somewhat seriously collected them as a little kid, and I'm like, I could actually do this, like, as an adult collection. Right. And I never even thought about that before I saw that book.
It was the second Star Wars book to come out in the new era after the first volume of Tim Zahn's Thrawn trilogy. Mm-hmm. So that came out in 91. This came out in 92, along with the second volume of Tim. So it was the first nonfiction book in the new era. So
And it's a great book. I mean, we probably didn't really introduce it that well at the start, but I mean, for people who aren't familiar with it. I mean, it takes you through the George Lucas's original idea for the movie, the making of the movie, and then the licensing, you know, the development of toys, and it's concise, it's not too long, gives you tons of great details, as we've been talking about, and, you know, for years I've said, and I still feel that way, that it's probably my favorite book on Star Wars, because it doesn't just approach it as a movie. It takes it into the licensing and the merchandising, which to me is, you know, 50% of Star Wars in a lot of ways.
Right, and it goes beyond just the Kenner stuff, because, I mean, there's extensive interviews with Charlie Lippincott and Mark Pevers of Fox, and, you know, some of the stories they tell about the troubles of the early game. Are just sort of fun, and you know, getting thrown out of toy showrooms and stuff like that.
I think part of the appeal for me as a kid who grew up loving those making of specials, and, you know, having, you know, Star Wars to me, part of the experience was those making of specials where I could see the guys making the movies. The book kind of tied into that and extended it into the licensing and the merchandising stuff. So to me, when I first read it, I was just like, oh man, this is just fascinating. I probably read it twice, you know, straight through the first time I got it.
And also, I mentioned it earlier, but a thing that I see in similarity between Ron's writing on the archive and Steve's writing is a kind of sense of humor. And, like, as an example, just there's a picture of two Jawas, and Steve subtitled it, "A couple of Jawas setting out to do some scavenging." no doubt. And like, it's just a little detail.
That's my weird sense of humor. Yes.
Yeah, but it's great, and it totally makes it almost like. I mean, not like the New Yorker or something, but you know, like you have to have the cartoons to go along with. You have to have a little injection of humor, and I don't know. I like how that's kind of continued on. And
I've always tried to write conversationally. Right. Very hard to do in an encyclopedia, but otherwise.
Steve's always been a terrific writer. He just gets right to the point. And, you know, that was another question I had, or just a point even that, you know, it seems like your experience, you touched on this already a little bit, but your experience as a reporter really probably set you up perfectly to do this kind of thing.
I think you're right.
Because it's such an investigative reporter type of thing, and the writing is so to the point, to the facts, you know, focused on the anecdotes. You seem to know what people are going to get a kick out of. You know, it just seems like you were perfectly set up to do this, you know, based on the Star Wars stuff and being a Wall Street Journal guy. So, I mean, to me, it's just a great convergence of stuff.
Well, you know what? I should look back and look at all my tapes and notes and...
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah.
What was left out?
Go find that box, yeah. Steve. Do a new edition, Contact Chronicle, and we'll produce it, you know?
I
want to go back to the Gamorrean Guard, because I didn't bring it up because you made a mistake. See, I didn't know you made a mistake, because I'm of the generation of collectors who wouldn't care about the Gamorrean Guard Bank, much to Ron's chagrin. And so that's part of, like, that was sort of my point, was that, like, here's this great thing, and I feel stupid, because how do I not see how cool that is? And now somehow, you know, there's just these certain things that were really important that seem to have fallen aside.
Right. Yeah. Yeah,
but did you know, Steve, that the remedial reading kit that you have a great write-up about is actually on eBay, and you could easily buy one if you wanted to right now?
For $22,000?
Yes. Yes, $22,000.
Yeah, well, actually, I have a second one, so maybe I'll put one up and undercut it.
I like that item, and we'll defend it as a great and fairly hard-to-find piece.
Oh, I love that item, too, especially the purple... What do you call
the mimeograph sheets?
The mimeograph sheets.
And they smell like preschool.
They still smell. They still smell. And then the 5 books and the film strip. And actually, I gave the film strip to, or I scanned the film strip for Tops, and they used it as a series of 10 cards in one of their sets a couple of years ago. So,
that's something that no one's ever going to see, you know, unless they pull out, they get one of those kits and they run that film strip. See one of those old projectors.
Right, because the black and white art in the books is not the same as the color art on the film strip. So it's very cool. Very cool.
And I do like, too, that you mentioned the book that Lucas was actually proud of it. You know, that maybe his whole educational push, like, it's really clear how concerned George Lucas was about sugar and education.
Right.
And it's interesting in terms of seeing him, because people don't always paint him in a flattering light. But I kind of like this side.
George, to me, is a creative genius. He's a hell of a nice guy. Look, you know, it's so easy to criticize these days on the internet without leaving your name, and not a very brave way to do things. But I still think the world of George and the amazing world that he created that we can still play in, and for years to come.
Yeah, and that's...
Another question I had, I guess, leads into that is, I'm assuming this book helped you get a job at Lucasfilm eventually, and it was a few years later that you went to work there, correct?
Well, I had started, actually, I went from this to the Tomar Price Guide, and from the Tomar Price Guide to the Encyclopedia, and I was still at the Journal, and making a decent salary and having a good job, and got this call out of the blue saying, could you recommend somebody to work for a year at practically no money to go out to talk to fans? And I said, let's talk. And I took a huge huge leap of faith and a huge drop in salary, and never looked back, and had an amazing 15 years at Lucasfilm. And
well, the hobby's better for it, Steve. I mean, you did a great job. You know, well, I have done a great job.
Thank you. And come and visit us at Rancho Obi-Wan anytime.
Yeah, we should put in a plug here, because the thing was, I didn't want to talk about Force Awakens at all, because I heard your interview with Rebel Force Radio, and so people can go listen to that if they want to hear Steve talk about a movie. But we definitely do. And the other thing is, I'm very frustrated because you may not know this, Steve, but I actually started the California Vintage Collectors Club, and then Steve took it over. And then he's been up to your place twice, and I've never been there. So I always see these pictures.
We know. You'll make it someday. We'll be here for a long time. We've got a lot of activities coming up this year that are going to be fun. We have our fifth anniversary gala, November the 5th, which is exactly 5 years since we had our big grand opening. Mm-hmm. So. But lots of other cool stuff that we'll be able to announce in the fairly near future, and people can just go on. Yep,
it's a great facility, and you know everyone should check it out. And there's a gift shop, and I'm assuming, Steve, you can probably buy from concept to screen the collectible there if you don't have them already. Assuming you still have copies.
Unfortunately, it is sold out.
Wow. Oh no!
What about the punishment cure?
I still have a couple of copies.
I'm going to get my autographed copy of that someday. That's my new collecting goal.
Oh, my God. Yeah, there are still some people who sell that on eBay. But
well, if you're listening to this,
your best bet is getting it on eBay.
Okay.
Yeah, well, if you're listening to this one, you should, you know, patronize Rancho Obi-Wan, because it's great for the hobby and doing great things for the hobby. And two, you should try to find a copy of the book, even though Steve is out of them, it's still out there, I'm sure. So definitely something that should be in your collecting library.
Another thing to say, too, is that because it's made by Chronicle, I think this is my theory, Steve, I could be wrong, but Chronicle makes great design, and they have smart and sleek, but they're not always as practical as they could be. So it doesn't say on the cover, Steve Sansweet. It doesn't say from screen to concept to collectible. It just has a picture of Darth Vader's head. And right. So there's more than one Star Wars book with Darth Vader's head on the cover. So if you see a big gold head, that's the book that you want.
And this, it has it on the spine, but I was amazed when I saw that too. And they just said, okay, we think we're gonna try to do this. And it also, if you have a hardcover book, they actually did a small version of the cover in gold foil on the hardcover underneath the paper cover. I mean, so really nice.
I mean, it's interesting for the time. I mean, nowadays I think it seems kind of kooky just to have no title and the Darth Vader image on the front, but. Again, at the time, I don't think people realized there was not much Star Wars related on bookstore shelves. So when you saw that, it was like, oh, a Star Wars book, you know? So that's definitely probably what I first saw.
And that's what they said. With the cover, if the cover was out, everybody's going to know it's a Star Wars book. And if the spine is out, it has what the name is. So that's how they explained it to me. And it, you know, it sold very well, and I was very happy with it and how it came out. And I think it, for its time, it still holds up all these years later. So
it definitely does.
It certainly does, and that's why we had to do the 16th anniversary.
24th, I know it's not the right year, idiot.
But we just finally got around to doing this. But when it hits the official anniversary dates, we'll mention it again. But.
Sounds good.
We go pretty slow. Now, Steve, we haven't done our lightning round questions. Are you ready to receive the lightning round questions from the Kivecast?
I'm not sure, but let's try it.
So be it.
All right, well, the thing is, I know that you're a movie fan, so you might be able to answer this one. What's your favorite bad line from a Star Wars movie? And mine is, pilot, please land over there in that assembly area. Do you have a favorite bad line?
Anything that Rick Oley said.
Okay.
That little droid did it.
Wow, Ron, an unexpected Rick Olley line.
There you go.
Okay, boy, gee, I don't know if it's even fair to ask him the burning house question. I don't know. If you had to grab one item, would you be able to, and what would it be?
It would be the banner that was painted for the 1976 San Diego Comic-Con and Worldcon using Ralph McQuarrie's Starkiller image and this incredible logo that was done by the guy who did the poster for Endless Summer.
Wow, that's a fantastic piece.
It ties Lucasfilm. It shows Lucasfilm being aware of fandom a year before the movie came out, when other studios didn't give a shit, didn't even have movies that would appeal to to younger people, or you know, the sci-fi crowd or the fantasy crowd, and ties it to what I did for 15 years at Lucasfilm. And I think that's probably my favorite piece.
Wow, that's awesome.
That's a good answer.
Yeah, that's a – oh, actually, there's one more question too. You also mentioned that Kenner went to Toy Fair – no, Lucasfilm went to Toy Fair 77 to figure out if anyone would license it. Has any pictures survived from Toy Fair 77 with what they brought to Toy Fair?
Not that I have seen.
Okay.
I imagine they would have brought, you know, some of the black and whites from the set that – I mean, they had actually sent out photos to the major toy companies and précis of the script and things like that, you know, right around Toy Fair and right after Toy Fair. And of course, Mego denies throwing them out, but I've got two guys who say we were forcefully led to the exit.
And then the last question is the most philosophical and is may take a little second to answer, but if you were a vintage Star Wars, a piece of vintage Star Wars memorabilia, not what would you like to be, but what do you actually think you would be if you were a vintage piece of vintage Star Wars memorabilia?
That is the weirdest question.
you know who gave the best answer? Aimee gave the best answer. Aimee said he would be a rebel transport because he's hollow inside. It was the saddest thing. We were there in Tokyo. Oh, I was in Tokyo asking him the question. I know you've worked with him a lot. And that was his answer. So no one's ever going to do better than that. So that's the high bar.
I think I would be a first sculpt Ewok. Because I love the Ewoks, and so many people don't. And so I would be proud to be an early version of an Ewok.
Spoken like a man who showed up at Celebration on the stage dressed as an Ewok. Exactly spoken like that.
And I can tell you, as someone with two kids, Ewoks are the greatest thing from Star Wars, because that's what gets kids into Star Wars. And whether it's Lego or Kenner or whatever it is, Ewoks are absolutely the greatest.
Except I just bought a plush Ewok on sale from Christmas, and it has two buck teeth in the front along with its cane, and it is the ugliest fucking I have ever seen. And Ann said, "Why did you buy it?" And I said, "Why? Because it's so awful." It's not obvious.
It's like when you first start out collecting, Steve, you're looking for all the really nice stuff. And then when you get really into it, all of a sudden you're like, you're buying all the really ugly and weird stuff.
It's like all
progression.
Wow. Hey, this is a man who has six different cans, as I said, of Hungarian Star Wars niblet corn with different Force Awakens labels on them.
That's the best part of Rancho Obi-Wan for me, is just there's never fails. There's something
never
off the wall.
And it always changes, and we're constantly changing and trying to add, and we've got lots of good things coming up.
Well, it's funny, because even you saying that, then that makes me want to ask you another question, because I didn't realize the whole fight between Lucasfilm and Kenner about plush toys, that Kenner didn't think they could do it well, and that's another thing that's in your books. I feel like we could just talk to you all night, Steve. I feel like we just need to stop at some point, but people need to go out and get the book and go to Rancho Obi-Wan. I think that's the
Well, let's do this again sometime and talk about some more specific things. I would love
to. Absolutely. Well, thanks, Steve. This was awesome. I mean, we've been talking about it since Seattle a few years back, so I'm glad that we finally did it.
I am too.
Yeah, and it's all because Steve won. Steve Danley's microphone broke. I'm like, well, we have to do something this month. So I'm like, I'll finally get around to doing it. But he's here to join the other Steve, so that's good.
That was. I don't think you needed me. I was just fun to kind of to listen.
Yeah, you were. Yeah, you were sort of in a trance, Steven.
Guy and I are such big. Fat blabbermouth. Yes. Sometimes whenever he has me on, I feel like I minimize Steve Danley, which is annoying to me because Steve Danley is essential to the podcast, I think.
Yes. Well, he's the star, so he gets
pretty much. He's a nice guy to your jerk.
We had a wonderful, wonderful visit with the California Vintage Fly. It was about twice the size of the first one, I think.
I mean, that was the biggest. I mean, I think Anne was a little nervous getting so many of us in there. And that was the first time she'd cooked, like, two things of brisket. So, I mean, it was...
Was that the best ever?
It was amazing.
Oh, my
God.
Yeah. Anne's Texicali brisket is, like... I mean, this is a special tour, guys, that we do for big groups. Yeah, for nuts. And you know, we add on Anne's homemade brisket and cornbread and beans.
Wow.
It's two
favorite things in one day over like a 6-hour period. I was just, I don't know.
Six? I couldn't get you guys out for 8.
Maybe it might have been. Yeah, that's being generous.
The first time you had me there, Steve, I think we were, 3 in the morning or something. We were up real late that night.
And then the next day, and it was fun. Yeah. It's good. You know, I love doing it with fellow collectors. And I also love doing it with people who just have the faintest idea what they're coming into. And there are therefore a couple of major reveals in the museum that you don't know what's coming. And just when your energy is sort of sagging, will he ever shut up? Then there's another big reveal. So it's great fun for me to watch people and to get the reaction and sometimes get very surprised by people who have been quiet the whole tour and then at the very end are just effusive. And of course I also do relationship counseling. Because I hear, honey, as long as you don't get this crazy, I guess I can live with what you have.
Well, after you bought all those collections that were broken up by divorce, I guess you have a lot of experience.
I do indeed.
Awesome. Cool. Well, we will find another good reason to have you on, Steve. Thank you for your time. And thank you for writing this book that, I mean, this confirms the thesis that I came in with as being sort of the beginning of the vintage hobby. It really does seem like this is it. This is the alpha of the whole hobby. So,
well, it's nice to hear you say pleasant things about it because I've also had people blame me for starting them out. I could have had a lot of money in my life, but your damn book ruined it.
Yeah, page 93. That's what I think I'm going to call Ron's generation of collectors, the page 93 collectors, because that's where the Luke Hoth layout is with all the sculpt and the hard copy and the squeezings.
Yeah.
Sounds good to me.
All right, cool.
Thanks a lot, Steve.
Okay, guys, thank you very much. It's been a pleasure.
Good night.
All right, have a good one.
Hey.
Hello.
Hey, all right. So,
that was awesome.
Yeah. I'm now back with Ron and Steve, the real Steve, not Steve Sansweet. that was so awesome.
Yeah, I mean, I knew it would be. I mean, Steve's, you know, he's a great talker, and he has tons of great stories. So.
He just knows how to tell a story. It's the same with the book.
But I just didn't, I thought it would go well. I just didn't think it would go that well. I'm so happy that he was like... totally opened all the questions and like he understood the sort of the angle and
I mean one of the reasons Steve Sansweet's such a treasure to the hobby and has been for a long time is he's just a good guy and you know he's a smart guy too and I, like Steve Danley said, I mean he's great with a story and he has a great sense of you know, how to structure things, you know, as a writer and when he talks. And he's just really generous, too. So, I mean, I'm not surprised he gave you that much.
We should have had him on the ethics episode because that's awesome. That's so cool, the idea that he knew he could have asked to buy all the prototypes, but it's just like you just don't do that. You know,
well,
like
I know that story. Like, so I guess I cheated a bit because Steve, we had talked about this before, Steve and I. But also when, you know, me and some other guys around Cincinnati buying stuff, people would sometimes tell us that Steve Sansweet was out there, and, you know, and they're like, oh, you know, he didn't really offer me anything. I just remember sitting there thinking, I was like, well, yeah, I mean, he's there, it's work, you know, it would be weird for him to try to buy this stuff from you. But yeah, I mean, what Steve said is sort of accurate. You know, he did that stuff, and a few years later, other people bought it, which
right.
is kind of interesting. And I'm sure, you know, he's a collector like anyone else. I'm sure, you know, part of him wishes he had that stuff.
But the thing is like, sort of karmically speaking, he wouldn't be in the position he's in of being like the sort of patriarch of Star Wars collecting if he didn't have those ethics, I think. Like, if you weren't such a good person, I don't think he would have made it so far in the world.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. I think you're saying, in other words, kind of what I was saying, just like, you know, part of the reason he's been around so long and that people like him so much is that he's a good guy.
Right. So just that goes for you, Steve. So you continue to be a good person and eventually good things will happen for you.
I don't know. Danley has some work to do on the good person stuff. We'll see. We'll get there.
Do you know how hard that was to have such a long interview without me being able to say Steve and have it be referring to you, Steve? That was.
I was internalizing that. Like, I'm just, that may not almost made it easy for me to just stay like my old self and completely silent, because it just would completely throw it off.
Because I literally had no idea how to address you, because I wasn't gonna be like, hey, Danley, like I'm some like.
You should have just called me Daniels.
Like,
you know?
Yeah, like a middle school job.
Anyway. All right, guys. Well, unless you need more from me, I guess that's all she wrote.
All right. Sounds good. All right, Steve. So we just finished recording the intro. We just finished listening to the interview with Steve Sansweet. Now let's just throw on this little bit of discussion with Chris Georgoulias to talk about what's happening now. This is kind of like in the news, because a couple things happened that are big deals, and so that's just going to be me, and then you're going to join later, Steve, because we're jumping all around in time. We're like George Lucas here, you know. Episode 1 before episode 3, all that stuff. So
yes.
Let's talk to Chris Georgoulias all about what is Blue Harvest and what in the world is a double donged Boba Fett.
Something tells me that's a Sky term.
The double donger? Everyone's not calling it the double donger Fett? No?
Well, they might now.
Well, you know, speaking of bad words, I got a text from Ron encouraging me to leave the one swear word that Steve Sansweet said in the podcast.
I was wondering how you might react to that.
Well, I think I might leave it in. I left in one swear from Derek Ho, I believe. I think that's the only other swear I've ever left in. But
hey, did you bleep? I think I must have had one like way back.
Oh yeah, you've had a bunch. Oh, every episode. You guys who listen don't know. He just.
They're
mostly racial slurs, which is weird. But I edit them out like, all the time.
Wow. Wow.
All right. Well then, let's listen to Chris Georgoulias. All right, Chris. Well, before Steve actually makes it here, and before anything else goes on with the show, you know, we've got these three topics we're going to discuss with you. And the first is the one I think I understand the least. My trademark is still
stupidity. Your trademark is stupidity.
And I don't understand. The thing is, okay, so I think, you know, I bought a head test pull thing, and I saw the things that Ross Barr had, the Beehive Han, like I held it in my hand at a New York meeting, but I don't actually understand anything that's going on. So what is this Klimko sale? What does it all mean, Chris?
What does it all mean? Well, I guess that's the name of the seller on eBay.
Okay.
And, you know, his round of sales in December really what got everybody's attention.
Okay.
He is ex-Kenner sculptor, as he notes in his listings. And
you can confirm that he was an ex-Kenner sculptor?
I can confirm, because we bought stuff from him 15 years ago.
Okay.
And 7 years ago also. So it's these guys, you know, they have stuff, and once in a while they run across another box of little things. And this time he took full advantage of the hype in December for Star Wars. He couldn't have picked a better time, and basically listed a lot of little, they were like head pull tests, basically a first shot, like a torso and a head in most cases, usually in odd colors, not painted. There's a few that were painted, but pretty much it was just torso and the head. Some of the torsos, he had loose torsos. That were not welded, not sonic welded. So anyway, a good variety of things, and he was a solid source, and it was public. And so he started the bidding, and he said that to discourage sniping,
okay,
which was interesting. He said if your winning bid is placed like 24 hours before the auction's over, he would throw in some extra things.
Wow.
So
he was trying to get people to, I didn't hear that bid, part.
You didn't hear that part yet. So, I mean, it was in his listings. He probably had, I don't know, 20 things. So, anyway, so that drove a lot of stuff. So, and right now, you know, with it was like all the stars were aligned for him, you know, and the fever pitch, you know, to get like prototype pieces, especially direct from the source, you know, people were just going nuts. And the bids were tremendous, you know. I mean, people were paying thousands of dollars for things that only a few years ago would have sold you know, maybe for a few hundred dollars.
Like, do you have an example from the Klimko sales that would, of something that sold for thousands that usually sells for $100?
Oh, yes. Actually, I'm going to kind of cheat because I had saved his auctions.
Of course you did, Chris. You save everything.
Well, he had, oh, here's something. He had a lot of paperwork.
Okay.
Paperwork. I forget how many pages. It was like less than 20 pages. Kenner envelope, just letterhead, you know, some handwritten things from Kenner. Sold for $2,500.
Wow.
$2,500. There's a first shot head for Luke Jedi, sold for almost $900. A General Maydeen. The torso is like an opaque plastic torso with a painted head, sold for $1,260.
Wow, and so that was probably just a testing thing for a test for the head pull to see if the head would come off, most likely? Or do you think it was an actual first shot? Or
It is a first shot. It's just that those at the time were earmarked for that particular thing, so that it didn't need all the legs. It didn't need the limbs assembled. It just needed the head on the torso. So they were testing it out, I guess, the neck pin size, and then likewise with the hole in the head, so that would get a good snap fit and, you know, would withstand being pulled on under some force. You know, I don't know what force they would pull on it to see what it took to either break it or pull it off. But so, you know, they would run those in the molds and just run a bunch of pieces and then send them out to Kenner and have those things tested. And he had loads and loads. I mean, he had lots of them 15 years ago. He had more in December. He's got more currently. So there, I mean, there's a whole new round of auctions. He did so well in his auctions in December that PayPal shut his account down.
Wow.
Because they thought something shady was going on. I mean, it was, and he had superpowers, Care Bears. He had a couple, he had hard copy, just a head and a torso. It was sort of like an after-the-fact made hard copy.
Okay.
For Luke Hoth. It sold for $9,766.
Okay, so it wasn't actually a hard copy.
It was a hard copy. It was like, you know, one of these spares. You know, lots of hard copy terms. But it was just the torso and the head.
Right.
And it was not finished. It was like made after the fact. It had little nub pins sort of molded into it. It wasn't a finished hard copy that you would pin together with steel pins. It was sort of made, you know, a lot of like sort of like a throwaway piece. And, you know, and they did that lots of times back then. Sometimes they would just run some extras if they had enough material.
Right.
And sometimes they make something just to keep. So some, just because these guys had something didn't mean it was actually part of the process. You know, sometimes, you know, they would make a spare for you know, they're just for posterity's sake. I think some of the stuff he had like that was made after the fact. Some of these guys would make like an extra copy of something just to have to base some future piece on, so they could be that much farther ahead, you know?
Right.
So anyway, on and on. I mean, he had a Rose Petal Place character, hard copy, sold for $800.
I don't even know what Rose Petal Place is. So there you go.
It's like a girl's toy line, you know, sort of like around the time of Strawberry Shortcake.
Right.
And on and on. I could go on and on. But I mean, he had some things that were like clearly just like wax castings. They were not sculpted. They were just poured castings, but they were in wax versus, say, Dynacast or some other material.
Okay.
I mean, those sold for, I mean, he sold for a Superpowers one for north of $9,000. So, I mean, most of those head pull tests were in the 1,000 to plus range. So, anyway, I can go on piece by piece, yeah, but you get the idea.
Well, just, to, I mean, as far as the head test pull, I mean, those toys did work. It was really hard to pull the heads off, so it's kind of a neat piece of history. Sure. I've been looking for years for a Chewbacca head test pull, but I haven't found one, Chris. I don't know why. Have you been able to find one ever?
It's rough, you know. I mean, I think they broke the equipment trying to pull the head off of the Porsche.
I think so, yeah.
I think, yeah.
Now, is there anything – so then there's nothing really shady about what it is. It's just that people are paying prices – that are maybe not commensurate with the actual it's sort of like we'll be discussing with the Blue Harvest pieces. It's not that they're bad pieces. It's just that the prices have gone so crazy.
Well, I would say the demand is to the point where that's what the prices are. You know, some of these you could argue that they're, you know, few of a kind in the world. So it's like, well, is it crazy then for that torso head combination to sell for $1,400 when nowadays a vinyl cape Jawa on the card has sold for $10,000-$12,000?
Right.
And those are much more plentiful.
Right.
So it's like collecting anything, I guess. You know, I was shocked at the prices, but it's just, it was like I said, the stars aligned, the demand was there, the notoriety was there.
And so probably the closest I came to it, you know, was I was hanging out at Yehuda's house during the most recent time I was hanging out there. And Ross Barr brought by the Han Solo with the weird stuff on his head. And he looked kind of like Marge Simpson. So then where does that fit into what is the theory on that? Because he told me, but I probably had too many jalapeno poppers and cognac to remember.
Oh, right. So that trip, huh?
Yeah. It was one of them.
So this sculptor, he sculpted the Han Carbonite figure, the action figure, I think. And he worked, I guess it was both pieces, because way back in the day, he had an alternate sculpt of the Carbonite block.
Wow.
And so this was a piece. It was just the torso and a head sort of cast together, a wax cast. And he had sort of sculpted a sort of, you know, 50s beehive Marge Simpson hair on top of it, just as a gag, you know, just a goofing around thing. It had nothing to do with anything except that he was at Kenner. You know, he worked doing Kenner stuff. And he wasn't always at Kenner. He was outsourced.
Right.
And I'm not sure. He said he worked on site some, but I think a lot of stuff he did is when he was freelance and outsourced for Kenner. Anyway, so there's no disputing it was done about the right time, but it had nothing to do with Han. You know, it could have been, it could have taken a Superpowers figure and done the same thing and had much less interest in it.
Right. So it was, but it was just kind of goofing around, not actually a part of the production process.
That's correct.
Okay. But it's goofing around by the guy who actually made it. So it sort of has, it's cool in its own way. Okay.
It's relevant.
Yeah.
You know, is it cool for, yeah. So Ross thought it was cool enough to buy it, you know, and he put in his bid early and, you know, he got a freebie, you know. So, you know, he's posted about that, I think, publicly. And,
right.
And you know, he got a, you know, I think it was a Luke Hoff wax casting. But now Klimko is selling one of those. So.
Right. So he's selling more. So
he's selling more. Yeah, he got a new round of first shot pieces he's found. And, you know, I don't think he'll do as well because, you know, there was a lot of hype then, but a lot of the same people are seeing this, you know, and a lot of people who bid these up, all of a sudden now you had two people going after the same thing. Now, what would a second one command, you know?
Right.
And I'm sure people think, well, how many more does he have? Because it's possible, you know, with these first shots, you know, they have bags of them, you know, he had 15 years ago had quite a number of these things. And, you know, just now in the past couple of months, even more, you know, and these wax castings, you know, because they're not hand worked, you know, some of them that are just castings are just things they poured. So,
right. So they would have just poured it into the mold that they had there and just taken from that. Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And not necessarily part, you know, like I said, some of these guys, they made things just to have for reference later. You know, if you needed like a male torso or part of a male figure about that proportion, heck, you'd have that one already sculpted to that point, you know,
right,
created to that point, and you could tweak it from there.
Wow.
You know, so, I mean, Kenner reworked some of their original sculpts into other figures. A lot of people don't know that. And
Well, actually, I've been working on Ron to he's going to put out a blog post about that, and he's got some bombshells to that effect coming up soon. So,
I'll steal his thunder then.
Yeah,
I didn't know he was working on that.
Yeah, well, maybe this will spark the fire for him to actually make that post, so he can make it, and it'll be amazing. But hey, let's move on to talking about the Blue Harvest.
Okay, sounds good.
It's been way too long since we've had you on, Chris.
It has been a while, hasn't it?
Yeah, I sent the email to you today, and I said, we need vitamin G. That's
Yeah, that was clever.
But I think it'd be a really good time, first of all, to talk about Blue Harvest. Do you know why I'm asking about Blue Harvest, Chris?
Could it have anything to do with eBay?
Yes. So did you see that a whole bunch of Blue Harvest pieces went up on eBay?
I think I just told you that.
Yes, you did. You see, that's why we miss having you. We need someone from North Carolina just to give me hell, because that's what that good state is for.
Right. No, you're right. I'm well familiar with those items.
Yeah, so it was this guy. I think he's a Pez seller. His name was like Pez Dude or something. And
a Pez author.
A Pez, what do you mean a Pez author?
Well, he wrote this definitive book on Pez. It's written in his auction descriptions at the bottom, just sort of saying, you know, he had been a dealer for 30 years, and he wrote this book in the 90s on Pez collecting.
Wow.
So that's his claim to fame. That's where the Pez comes from. He sells a lot of neat things in his listings.
You know, I think I might actually have that book, because I actually collected Pez before I collected Star Wars, Chris.
I think it's David Welch is the name
of it. Okay. Wow, that's funny, because I've been emailing him back and forth, and I've been trying to be respectful, because he doesn't seem like he's trying to scam anybody. But the wording is this. So just as an example, we'll go with the one that I paid attention to, which is a 4-up of Chewbacca in the torture chamber, unproduced torture chamber set. This is where you can correct me if it's actually a different set. That it was a torture chamber set, right, Chris?
That one, that's correct.
All right, I got one right. Take that, North Carolina. So its listing is Kenner ROG space test shot 4-up prototype action figure Chewbacca C-3PO. And I just sort of contacted him and said, you know, it shouldn't be listed as a prototype. And then he sort of said, well, yeah, it can be because I don't say it's original. And we kind of went back and forth. And he basically told me in a nice way that he's just going to keep doing what he wants. So if it is a Blue Harvest piece, which it is, what does that mean? What is the history of the Blue Harvest prototype scandal?
Scandal. Oh man,
is it not a scandal?
Well,
I thought it was a scandal.
Yeah, it's funny too, because it's grown as I'm trying to find his listing now to see. I have I had it bookmarked.
Well, that's fine.
Actually, he I guess we could go into it. He's actually, you know, for the crazy prices on here, you know, he lists things and then he relists them at a lower cost. But he sold the Power Droid for $1,800.
No way.
Yeah, and that would be from the dungeon, the Jabba dungeon set, and it was a Blue Harvest 4-up. And I'm sure the reason it sold is because these Blue Harvest pieces have sort of gained collector notoriety in the past, I don't want to say 10 years or so. You know, they first came to light in the mid-90s, a little late. Yeah, about mid-95, about 96, yeah, 95 actually, 96, right around there. And I think it was Steve Denny, actually, the man, the myth, the legend, that told me about them originally because he was tracking down Kenner people. And he got invited to this guy's house, and on the dining room table, the guy's like, yeah, I've had all these. And Steve is like thinking to himself, these don't look good. Something's wrong here. And he said, thanks, you know, I'm not really interested in these, and let it go at that.
Right. So what he thought he saw were, or what he was being told he was seeing were 4-up prototypes. So the prototypes for micro collection figures, mostly the unproduced sets at 4 times their normal size. And they should be in what, Dynacast usually? Is that right, Chris?
Right. So I guess I should, yeah, if we're going to go all the way to that, what they are, yes, 4-up. So the micro collection was sculpted at 4-to-1 size. So most of these pieces that you see are anywhere from like 4 to 6 inches or so tall. They were sculpted at that size and sort of prototyped. So the wax sculpting would have been made, or acetate sculpting, and then they would have made a silicon mold and made hard copies from that in what you said is Dynacast material. Typically, it was those, it was the green Dynacast, which is their hard copy material of choice at the time. I have seen some in the brown, that Carbolon material. But this blue stuff was really new, and Steve knew enough. He's like, these don't look right. Well, we were
right, because what he saw was a whole bunch of blue looking prototypes. He knew that's not the right color.
That's so right. They were all blue, a whole table full of them. He knew, okay, it's the wrong color, and there's way too many of these in one person's spot place. And they looked new. They were sort of like as cast and not all finished, you know, and sort of cleaned up. So yeah, so these blue things were there on the scene, and you know, they slowly dispersed into the marketplace, being sold as authentic prototypes. I think several dealers at the time were buying them. One of the stories was, well, Kenner went back to the molds and was cranking things out just to sort of get ideas for revamping the Star Wars line, which is right around the time that, you know, that Kenner re-released, sort of did their 9 new action figures. The POF 2 line was born. The classic 4-pack, which was, you know, the vintage, those were the recasts of the vintage, the 4 vintage figures.
Right.
And so this was sort of all in that time frame. And these were made at Kenner by some person or persons at Kenner. And with the mold, because the molds, the original molds were still there in the basement. So they had access to the molds, they had access to this hard copy material. What they didn't realize was that they didn't start using this blue material until, I think, 89 or 88. So it was after the vintage years. So that was the easy way to know, okay, these aren't original, because Kenner didn't start using the material until after the fact.
Right.
So
basically, these things have been circling around the hobby for whatever, 15, 20 years.
Right. Yeah, like 20 years now. You know, they're almost cool, you know, sort of antique, vintage, you know, just in some year, you know, some people, you know, 20 years old is that makes them kind of old for these toys. Now, they weren't just the 4-ups. They're actually action figure pieces as well that were found, all made sort of at the same time. And, you know, we've run across that too. Arms and legs and complete figures, things that were sort of finished and drilled and put together nicely. Some of the better famous ones are the 8D8 and the EV99, which were for the action figure line. Those two figures were sculpted at 2-to-1 size. So this was like the first time we'd ever seen that we knew that these things existed at this scale. So they're pretty impressive to see those figures twice as large as normal. And usually all the ones that had turned up were all finished very nicely.
Right.
They were pinned together. The 8D8, the arms and legs were, the pins were part of the sculpting. So they were all, they fit together nicely. And that was, even at the time, you know, those things were selling for anywhere from like, I'd say $300 to $600. I mean, lots of them were selling for $500, right, because that was the only way to get that.
Right, and an authentic one would sell for $600. So these were made to deceive.
No, they weren't authentic. I'm saying that the Blue Harvest 8D8 and EV99 were selling for that.
Oh,
much.
Really? Wow.
Blue Harvest was, because it wasn't until years later that some authentic hard copies of those two actually turned up.
Right.
So, and then there was painted ones. Like I have painted 8D8. That was supposedly like made as like a sample to like a display piece to show, like it sort of went along with the story that they were trying to rehash some of these things in the 90s just to get some ideas around.
Right.
And it was gorgeously painted, but it's one of the blue ones.
Right. Huh. Well, I don't, it's always, so I saw this and I kind of contacted the guy and he was a little bit standoffish. And he was trying to say that because he doesn't use the word original, it's not misleading to call them prototypes. But it is misleading to call it a prototype if it wasn't actually used as a prototype, right?
Well, you know, a lot of people on eBay probably beg to differ on that. I think the problem with him is that he really didn't know what these were, and he bought these from Tomart Publications. And at the time, they were heavily invested into these pieces. And they didn't know what they were. And then when people were confronting them with the fact that, hey, these things were made later, they always maintained, no, they're original. But, and they had shown them in their magazines, Action Figure Digest. Well, when they did their hardcover version of their Star Wars Collectibles price guide, the hardcover version had a whole section in the back that had about 20 color pages of prototypes. Well, they went and showed those blue four-ups, but they colorized them to make them look sort of like dingy gray-green.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. So it was like, wait a minute.
Oh, that's sketchy.
You're going to sell it. First, you're going to say that they're real, and then when you show the picture of them, you're going to colorize them. So that was like, that was just bad. And, you know, when they went and sold there, they started selling off their collection of stuff. They had a ton. I went to their place a couple times. They had an enormous collection of all kinds of toys, and they had several cases of Star Wars and a lot of real things, you know, authentic pieces.
Right.
But they have those blue things, and like I said, they were sort of heavily invested in that, and they didn't want to relent on the fact that no, they were good. So they were moved along, and you know, I think this seller now, he bought a bunch of those pieces. His price was more or less justified on one auction. I think he's had some other ones. I think he probably made a side deal on some. So even though they're not original, because they were Kenner made,
right,
and they're of like unproduced toys and things, that there's enough collectors out there willing to know that and still pay a certain amount of money.
Wow.
And so, and it could be hundreds. You know, collectors are selling them to each other for decent amounts. I was surprised to see that one sell for $1,800.
Yeah.
That just shows that people are dying to get anything nowadays, even something like this.
Oh.
So Blue Harvest came. I think I can remember who named that. I could swear I thought it was me on the early forum days. We were trying to think of a name of it. Just said it was a clever play on words.
Yeah.
And that, you know, That stuck, and you know, there's quite a mystique now and sort of admiration almost of these to some degree, you know. But then there was also a group of guys out of Cincinnati that were making fakes of these, and those have no – those that was made by a bunch of some guys that called themselves Basement Bounty Hunters. Some of these pieces you'll find in really weird colors. The details are, yeah, that can be mold, that can be a little bit washed out, and because they made their own molds off of Blue Harvest pieces, and in a few cases they made their molds off of original pieces, but they made these fake four-ups and they sold them, you know, for low values and stuff. Lots of them around Ohio, the collectors meets down there, the Ohio Collectors Club, and they, some of them say BBH on the bottom,
right?
And those are definitely fakes, and those, you know, but they don't have zero value because people would buy them just to have a display piece, you know?
Right. Yeah, I have one in my collection, and it's pretty nice. Awesome. Well, listen, Steve just texted me actually 10 minutes ago to say he's ready to talk. So I'm going to call you back, and we're going to talk about the Double Donger Fett, okay?
Sounds great.
All right. Okay, so if you're listening to the episode, you've been hearing Steve and I talk for the last hour or so, but we're just, Steve just got in from the Academy. Steve, were you polishing your Oscar?
No, I don't get none of those.
No. We just talked about Blue Harvest with Chris. I don't think we're going to get to the third topic, but so what actually happened?
Okay, so... in December, there was a few of the Cincinnati collectors were working with the library there. They wanted to do something to commemorate Kenner. So Dan Florida and Josh Blake and the guys over at KennerCollector.com, they helped set up a display out there, working with the library, researching old photos and things, and had a full day, a Kenner symposium. Brian Stillman was there. He showed his Plastic Galaxy documentary.
Yep.
Unfortunately, I couldn't make it. I had prior engagement, so I missed out on that. But it was a really good event. It was like on a Saturday, and it was the kickoff of a exhibition or display that would stay there for some time. I forget how many months, but you know, it spanned every decade of Kenner and showing various toys and things. They had people from the toy company there, you know, telling stories and whatnot. But so there was a guy there. Turns out this quality engineer, former quality engineer, was there. Had mentioned to a few people that he had a rocket firing Boba Fett. And one of the guys there, Daryl Johnson, he approached him, said, "Hey, I'm really interested in this piece." And that was in mid-December. And I'd say a couple of weeks ago, they've finalized their deal, and he went to Cincinnati to pick up the piece. He had seen photos on the guy's phone of it. He knew it was like a J-slot Rocket Fett, which is sort of the last design iteration of that figure. It was like fully painted, looked like a production figure with dates in the right color, and the shape of the slot in the backpack was sort of a J shape, and that was to prevent sort of like misfiring from like knocking the firing pin
right
to the side, which is how the original, the L slot, we call them, Boba Fett's, those were designed. Anyway, so, and the guy had mentioned, you know, it's got a couple of missiles and a little box. And at the time, Daryl said it didn't really phase him because he wasn't thinking. He was just really excited to get the Rock Fire Boba, just to get the Fett itself.
Right.
And, so he had talked to some other people. I think he was talking to Steve Dwyer a lot. And Steve had written me a couple of weeks ago and said, "Hey, have you ever heard of one of these in a mailer box?" And I was like, no such thing. Well, they sent the photos and said, "Hey, this thing turned up." And I was like, "Oh my gosh, two missiles." I said, "That's how it was promoted." So I remember there was a catalog supplement that came out in early 79 that mentioned that it came with two rockets. And this was just a plain mailer box. It was essentially the same mailer box that went out to kids who got the figure via mail order. But this had a little sample. The baggie was unmarked. At the time when Daryl got it, he showed it to some other Cincinnati collectors, and Bill Wills had confirmed, "Hey, I have a," he had a like an early mailer sample a regular Boba Fett, and had a similar, you know, box with no label and a similar unmarked baggie. The one that Daryl got was the baggie was open because the guy, the engineer, had opened it, but he said, you know, he just kept it like that the whole time. So
right.
And so that was it, you know. And I was, you know, I was like, man, that was really cool to see one in a sample state. I know Daryl and Steve were very excited. There were a lot of people that were really, really excited. And then I mean, I liked it, but, you know, I was like, hey, you know, the J-Slot Fett turned up 22 years ago.
Right.
So it's not, that was new. So it was nice to see that it was in a box like that. You know, it would have been really amazing if, like, it had a letter in it that said, here's how to operate the mechanism or something, but it didn't have any paperwork in it.
Right.
So,
what?
Yeah. I believe the story, you know, that he said, guy from the Kenner guy, everybody, you know, he was there and it made sense. So, but the way it was unveiled was sort of new. They spent 24 hours on Facebook saying the greatest thing in the world was coming up. So,
Gabbo.
Well, kind of like that. Yeah, sort of like took a cue from Disney, you know?
Right.
And,
yeah, totally.
So they had a Force Friday, and then everybody was jazzed up trying to guess what this could be, you know. And then on Saturday, you know, they unveiled what it was, and there was quite a bit of commotion. And you know, I think a lot of people had never seen a Rocket Finder Boba Fett. It didn't seem like it, and you know, and it was great.
Yeah, it's a cool story, and I had never actually picked up that it was going to be shipped with two rockets. I mean, was that just in a catalog they announced that, or why had I never seen that?
Yeah, I mean, it was in this January February 1979 supplement. It's like it was the first time that there was like in the printed material that they advertised the figure.
Right.
You know, aside from the card backs, that's the only bit of marketing literature I'd seen. So I knew about that. I've had one of those forever. And so that was one thing that struck me. As soon as he said it's two rockets, like, oh yeah, that's how it was promoted.
Right.
At least very early on. You know, that supplement I think was printed and, you know, and distributed back in August of 78. So it had been out for a while because it was promoting items that were going to come out in January, February 79. And Toy Fair is in February. In fact, they just had Toy Fair this past weekend.
Right.
So in New York.
Well, awesome. Well, I think the other thing, unfortunately, we don't have a ton of time here, but the one thing I would say is that it is cool seeing the sort of the way that it came about on Facebook, you know, which is kind of this new thing we've been discussing, new, whatever, 15 years old, but like the sort of new way that things are shared in the hobby. And then there was a huge demand that people make a Rebel Scum forum out of it so that the discussion would be archived. And then finally, Chris, you put it up on the archive itself so that it's like totally archived and completely safe and easily findable. And that kind of gives me hope in the future that discoveries like this, okay, maybe it won't ever be this big of a hype in the future, but it's cool that something new happened. We got to have the excitement, and then we also get to have the sort of the real sense of building history. So thanks for writing that, and thanks to those guys for finding it and sharing it, because it's cool. It's something new in our hobby.
Yeah, it was something I was just thinking about with the Facebook thing is, I can't remember who made the comment, but someone kind of likened it to some of the craziness on the old archive, like chat room, which unfortunately I never really got to experience, but it kind of had that feeling to it in the sense of people just kind of going nuts on the fly.
Right. Yeah, awesome. Well, listen, Chris, can we contact you next month, too? Can we have 2 months in a row of vitamin G?
Sure thing.
All right.
You can't overdose on vitamin G.
You really can't, because you have a lot more to say to us, and you're always the most vocal about us recording shows. Basically, every email I send to him, Steve, he just goes, okay, good, get back to podcasting. So...
I think you might need a new vitamin G drop for this.
Maybe
guy.
The old Pokemon one is wearing thin. All right, cool, awesome, Chris. Well, then we will talk to you in episode 71. And thanks for coming on and dropping some vocab on us.
All right, guys.
Thanks, Chris.
All right.
Tell Steve I said the other Steve I said hi.
Yeah. You know what? I like the place. No diggity, no doubt. Play on, play it. Play on, play it. Yo, Dre, drop the verse.
All right, Steve. Well, we're now ready to record the outro. You're still recovering from me accusing you of spouting out racial slurs. You don't like that, huh?
Well, I mean, I've already been called an animal abuser, so...
That's true. And we've already established that if you're going to be a nice guy in the hobby, you have to work a little harder.
Yeah, I know. I've got a lot of work to do.
Yeah.
I'm seeking help, though, right? I mean, yeah. I can go back to see Sansweet's book and
so. Yeah, and I just love the idea that you know, that the book was taken down to Cincinnati by all the raiders, you know, like,
yeah,
and just,
yeah,
like, hey, no, let's look up this guy.
Rereading it the last couple days, I just didn't realize how many names are in the book. They're all over the place.
What do you think of calling them the page 93? Is that too esoteric?
I mean, when have we not been esoteric? I mean, Ron, if you see the picture, it absolutely makes sense.
Yeah, so because basically it's in the concept screen to collectible book, and it just shows the complete evolution of the sculpt of the Tauntaun. And I didn't really hammer it too hard, but the whole idea that, like, this is the book that informed that generation, and they,
right,
and they care about 3D stuff, and then, like, what I consider to be my generation,
yeah,
was so influenced by Kellerman, and then, yeah, that's all 2D stuff. Like, it makes sense. So, like, what's the next, you know, what's going to be the next book? Who knows?
I don't know.
Maybe it'll be Joe's book, and it'll make the bootleg generation.
I hope so.
So, next month we'll be back with Grant. We'll be talking about TIE Pilots, and we'll have some standard old, good old Kivecast fun. Wampa Wampa.
Adios.
All right.
Cool.
I like the way you work it. No diggity. I thought to bag it up. Bag it up.